We all have a dream.
And with dreams comes sacrifice.
And a hope.
And a reason to live.
We all fight for a dream. As immigrants, our dream is
the American dream.
Sueño americano.
America.
El norte.
The United States of America.
Los Estados Unidos de America.
We migrate.
For our family and ourselves in order to have better opportunities.
We migrate.
Because our country is stricken by economic problems.
We migrate.
Because of the gangs in our country who kill innocent people.
Being an immigrant is being a person who fights to have a better life.
We all have a dream.
The American dream.
Urapan, Michoacan. I was named Maria, after my grandmother. I lived with my younger sister, father, and my grandma. My mom passed away after giving birth to my sister, leaving my dad and my grandmother to raise us.
I was born in a small town in Guatemala in 1976. I was given the name Alejandra. Before I started school, my only friends were my neighbors named Ana and Carmen, whose parents had been to El Norte numerous times and brought back multiple toys, bicycles, rollerblades, and other fun items. They were the richest people in town. They even ate french fries with ketchup. Being that my family could barely afford to make enough money to feed me and my siblings, I didn't have any toys. So I did everything Ana and Carmen ordered me to do just so that I could play with their toys.
¿Qué onda, amiguis? ¿Puedo jugar con usted?
¿Sí? Sí, sí. ¿Lavar los trastes? ¿Puedes andar en mi bici?
¿Necesito que lavar los trastes? Ok, sí lo haré. Gracias.
While they got driven to school, I had to wake up at about 5 a.m. every day to see if I had to do my hour and a half walk to school or take the bus. It was a struggle to decide if I should walk the distance and use the money to buy a torta or take the bus. I would mostly walk.
I was born in Anguilla, Michoacan, Mexico on July 20th, 1929. You see, growing up then, people didn't have a lot of money. Michoacan is filled with families living in poverty, as well as a lot of orphans. As for me, I'm part of the population of kids who grew up without a father. I spent my teenage years working in a bakery to help support my family. I'd help prepare the flour as well as cleaning and other small jobs. During my free time, I played baseball with the kids from El Pueblo, the village.
Miguel, ¿ven a jugar baseball con nosotros?
No, gracias. Necesito trabajar.
Ándale, necesitamos uno más.
No puedo, lo siento.
¿Para qué molestas? ¿Pero vas a la fiesta?
De veras, traté de ir.
Para la novia, si tiene tiempo.
¿Va a estar cerca?
Todavía no es mi novia.
Although I wasn't able to play too often, I fell into the same routine my adolescent years of waking up in La Madruga at around 3:30 a.m. just to go work in the bakery and sell sweets for made for people in the streets. This ended at around 2 p.m. when I'd go home to help my mom out. I really didn't have a lot of free time.
I was born in Tepic, Mexico. We were very poor, and my parents could barely afford to give us food and clothes. They were capable of maintaining their house. I had to be mature and realize the state in which my parents were, they were giving me my help. My sister worked, and I stayed home to watch my siblings, clean the house, and did other chores. I fell in love with teaching them. That is when teaching was born into my life. I told myself that I would become a teacher, and nothing would change that. My mother thought it was a great idea. I was 16 years young when I had my oldest daughter. Her father ended up leaving us, so I had to move in back with my mother. I knew from that day on, I wasn't going to become a teacher.
Lupita. I was born in the mountains of Hidalgo, Mexico. I was married early in life and had two beautiful daughters, but my husband died in an accident when they were very young, and I was left to raise them on my own. We worked the fields. I could not stand to watch as my two children constantly waste in pain every time they cut their hands from the field work. I could not take care of the pain that they're experiencing and their back and shoulders as they stood out in the hot sun with nothing to eat or drink. They had to work these conditions each day so that we could earn more money, yet we were still very poor no matter how long we each work. My daughters would always fear the snakes that would be in the fields. This was not the life for a child. My daughters would pick up old rags that other people would throw away so that they could make their own dolls out of them, since they had always longed for toys, but never had anything to play with.
Mamá, mira.
Encontramos esto para hacer muñecas.
Preciosas, mijas.
It broke my heart that I could not afford a simple toy.
Our house was made of four thick mud walls and a shaky tin roof that allowed lizards to fall from at night. We had a small rusty stovetop in one corner, a pit outside that we used as a bathroom, and we had our many cows and horses resting outside in the backyard. But it wasn't all bad. I could sometimes remember riding on horses and taking care of the cattle on the farm with my dad because I stopped going to school after the fifth grade. But I always looked forward to Christmas, where we bathed in the cold river water because it was still warm outside after we feasted on my grandmother's homemade tamales.
I was born on June 21st, 1967, to a family of 13 who all fit into a two-bedroom house in San Joaquin, Municipio de Antonilco, El Alto, Jalisco. I was given the name Jose Luis. Sometimes we did not have enough to eat. There were days when all we would eat was a tortilla with salt and lemon. It's hard to try and keep ourselves stable. At just 8 years old, I already had a lot of responsibilities that I had to fulfill. I had to mature at a young age. Went to work in the mornings, school in the afternoons, and I almost never felt safe when I would walk through my town. There was a lot of violence at the time, but I always had my eyes open and was ready for anything to happen.
I was raised in a home with dirt floors. I had no shoes of my own until I was a teenager. Life was a struggle. My father died when I was only 6 years old, so I had to assume the role of another adult in my household alongside my mother. We all lived in two rooms, my mom in one, and me and my six brothers and sisters in another. Un pan era para los ocho de nosotros. We didn't have the most money, but we had the means to have some sort of food in front of us every day and a roof over our head. And for that, I am thankful of, because we were happy.
Amen.
Amen.
Every summer, the town had a three-day party called La Fiesta, with live Mexican music called banda, carnival games, rides, lots of tequila and beer, a bullfight with a matador during the day, and the competition for the prettiest girl from the area. That's where I first learned about the US. I was 15 and I met people who came back with nice clothes and money.
tiempo de coronar la reina.
So I didn't have to leave.
One day, one of my brothers and I heard of an opportunity to travel to the U.S. Don't get me wrong, we were scared, but we knew we had a chance to make a better life for our family.
To come to the U.S., I had to borrow money, but that wasn't enough. I had to sell and kill some of our cows to get more money.
I heard about a group of people in my village leaving for El Norte. I knew that in order to provide for my family, I had to go with them. I'd be leaving behind my mom, son, and daughter who was on the way.
Saved as much money as I could and borrowed from other close family. I remember my mother telling me,
"No te vayas, no te vayas, hijito, es peligroso. Necesito mamá."
It was an emotional day, but I wanted to make a better future for myself.
The day I left, my mother began to cry, and she told me,
"Ven, mija, ve a ver una vida que no te puedo brindar aquí."
"Pero mamá, yo no quiero ir. Yo me quiero quedar aquí con usted y mis hermanas."
She told me that this was the best for me. But all she ever wanted was for me and my siblings to live the life she never could. She agreed to take care of my daughter so I can go build a better life for her. To this day, that moment has stuck with me as my mother's greatest sacrifice.
Finally, the day came, and my brother told me that it was time to go. I grabbed the bag I packed and said my heartfelt goodbyes to my family. I hugged my sisters and told them,
"Cuida mamá, por favor. Por mí, los veré pronto."
"Sí, sí, te extrañaré."
"No te vayas, te amo. No te preocupes, regresaré."
"Okay, qué bueno. Cuando regreses, te traes un güerito."
"Cuidado." I looked at my mother with her beautiful eyes and soft, pale skin and gave her the biggest embrace I could.
"Te amo y te extrañaré.
Que Dios te bendiga, mi hija."
Then we left.
It was 1986 when I found myself crying when it was time to say goodbye to my family. My father didn't say anything to us. He was furious that we were putting ourselves at risk. I could see the frown on his face and the tears that were forming under his eyes. He loved us and didn't want us to die.
Ignóralo. Yo hablo con él. Cuídense mucho, mis hijos. Los amo. Te amo, mamá.
We didn't know if we were ever coming back alive, but it was all a risk we were taking. A risk we were willing to make.
I said goodbye to my grandmother, and I set out. I'd never been out of my hometown, much less to another country. I almost turned back, but somehow didn't. I knew that this was the right thing to do.
I am the mother. I am supposed to take care of them. I never said goodbye to my daughters before I left because the thought of telling them had already made a dent in my heart. So telling them and watching the reaction would shatter it. Never said goodbye.
I was just 19 years old when I had to travel through the desert with a coyote. A coyote is a person who knows every pathway through the desert. I was carrying a little backpack with my clothes, 2 gallons of water, along with a huge spear.
I left Guatemala for the Texas border in 1994 at 18 years of age. I took a train called La Bestia Negra, and there were many encounters with death. You feel a lot of fear. Your adrenaline can rise in less than a minute. The train was crammed full of people trying to make it to the Texas border. It stinks of human excrement, and you have to cling on to the sides with no sleep and no food for days on end.
Buena suerte, cuidado. Apúrate, agarra esto.
Gracias.
Contigo. On the train, it was even worse for women. God, if you were a female and you were on this train, you had an even higher risk of getting kidnapped and being sold off for prostitution. I was lucky to have my brother with me. My brother, alongside the men that were traveling with us, formulated a plan. They would protect the women traveling with us. They would stand around us like a wall.
I was 17 years old when I left one day at dawn. It took me one day to get to Mexicali. I met up with a coyote. He took me and a few other people I did not know in a car. I was very scared since he kept flirting with me.
Tú vienes conmigo.
Oh, por favor, no quiero problemas.
Yo soy el menor de tus problemas.
I pray to God not to let anything bad happen to me. Once I arrived to Mexicali, I met up with the other people. In total, we were 20. I look at the faces of these people. They look so tired. They look so frightened. I feel bad for them. I feel bad for myself. But this is the life we got. I thought to myself, tenemos que sobresalir a como de lugar. I remember being so cold that my knees started to feel so weak.
I had a chocolate bar inside my jacket. That chocolate bar was my best friend for 2 days. I remember us being in the mountains. We had to cross a small river and got ourselves wet. I was tired, I felt exhausted, I was hungry, but I was thanking God for the life we had. Although it had been hard, He has taught me to value family. I thought it was going to end there.
We had to cross the river, El Rio Bravo, which is full of mud and rapids. Many people died trying to cross it. I think it was about 600 meters. Also, I got a cactus spike stuck in my right leg, making it really difficult to walk. As we came out from the other side and across the bushes, we saw people staring at us. They were annoyed because we were not local people. Some Mexicans are extremely hostile towards non-Mexicans. Because of that, there was a lot of tension. They told us to move on, so we continued walking for another 45 minutes and waited for the train, but it never passed. We had to go without food for another 4 days, and I think we ran out of water for a day, maybe more. The nights were so cold and the days were so hot. We tried looking for food and we found a shop, probably the only shop in the whole area.
Cuando no puedo venderte. Si alguien me ve, me meteré en problemas. Necesitas irte.
Estamos tan desesperados. Por favor.
No puedo ayudarte. Dije que te vayas.
We moved on and eventually came across some mango trees, but we couldn't climb them. It was actually kind of funny because while we were resting, you can hear the mangoes falling on the ground. And as we were about to go get them, all you hear are these pigs running and grunting toward the orchard. We didn't think it was so funny then, as we were so desperate for food. We were like, no, our mangoes! We had to wrestle with those pigs. And we were hungrier and more determined. So we got to eat 2 to 3 mangoes every day for 2 days. In the end, someone warned us that the police were coming. In Mexico, the police don't protect you like they should. Sometimes they would hurt you. So we ran. We continued along the train tracks and eventually found a place to sleep. The next morning, we heard a noise. I think it was a boy, 11 years or so.
Oh yeah! ¿Qué están haciendo aquí? ¡Esa es la propiedad de mi padre!
Llevamos días viajando y necesitamos ayuda.
Por favor, necesitamos agua y comida.
Cualquier cosa ayudaría.
No estoy segura lo que puedo hacer, pero ven conmigo.
His mom was actually a Guatemalteca girl, and this helped. His father was a really nice man, and he was Mexican. His father bought the food, and his wife cooked it for us. She made us a meal full of meat, beans, and sauce, and it tasted like heaven. They eventually agreed to help us find a way across the border. We were luckier than most to get this kind of help. We crossed the border with no problem and arrived in Texas.
We made it to the border, or else into a white van. 30 bodies, como salchichas, uno arriba del otro. None of us had tasted food or water in a while, much less fresh air. The other woman and I feared that we could be raped. It was the spring of 1996.
The most painful night was crossing the river. See, when we first got to the river, we had to hide in the grass because there were vicious crocodiles at the edge of the water. Now the grass underneath me was wet and cold, and it smelled like salt and dirt.
Cuidado con los cocodrilos. Los veos.
Sigue.
Espera mi señal.
All I heard was the low grumbling of the crocodiles, and it terrified everyone. I felt the need to cry, so I did. There was a white van on the other side of the river. We waited for the white van to leave, and when it did, we all raced through the crocodile-infested waters.
Se han ido, córrele, muévanse, muévanse.
I was soaking wet, and when I finally got out of the water, I had to run through sand. My feet got heavier and heavier, and it was hard for me to run. I had to be carried by my brother and another man because I couldn't keep going. At this point, I thought all hope was lost. If it weren't for my brother, I'm not sure I would have made it. The rest of the journey to the border was all a blur. See, all I remember my brother doing was looking at me and telling me, we had made it.
I traveled with a small group from my town. We were being led through the forest and deserts by a coyote. The hardest part was hearing from La Migra. Every time we would hear them, we would hide. I was always so scared and nervous that I would be caught and sent back. We had to go through deep rivers, dark tunnels, and cold forests. We had to crawl through the sides of freeways near water tunnels. And every time we would see a white van, all we did was run, and we didn't stop running.
¡Corre, esta migra! ¡Tengo miedo!
Yo también, pero vamos a quedarnos juntos. ¿A dónde vamos?
¡Mándate, bajo! ¡Por aquí!
We traveled along the border in the dark. We came to a place on the wall where we could crawl under. Following the coyote's directions, we stayed silent. And one by one, we reached American soil. I was 13.
I traveled up and met up with the coyote who would guide us. We walked through the desert where we walked a lot of miles. We had to hide in the bushes for hours to avoid being seen by both cops and ICE. But the worst part about it was the treacherous heat. It was so hot that my hands got burned when I touched the ground. And on top of that, I had a fever. After all of that, we finally made it to the border where we crossed without being caught. And finally, I was in the US.
Quiero mucho mis amores. Prometo que los veré pronto y tendremos una vida mejor. Todo lo que hago es por ustedes.
Te quiero, te extraño. Te quiero ver, mamá.
Yo también.
Hearing their voices gave me courage. Even though my heart ached, knowing it may be a long time before I would ever see them again.
I got my first job in the U.S. picking apples near the crops in Santa Rosa, California, from sunrise to sundown, each day. It was around the early 1950s, and they paid me based around how many boxes of apples I picked, and trust me, it was very little.
All right, let's see what you got for today. That's it. Open up here. Here you go.
Por favor, I worked all day in the right. Apple was right.
I don't care, you know how we pay. If you don't like it, you can find another job.
But you didn't pay me.
My first impression of Americans was not great. I expected them to welcome me with open arms, but instead, I was welcomed with pure ignorance and racism. I remember seeing signs in front of restaurants saying, "Se prohíbe las entradas a los moranos y los mexicanos." This new life was extremely difficult. I remember one day at work, one of my coworkers screamed "La migra" as they ran. See, I had to wear stilts in order to pick the apples, so I wasn't able to run. I didn't even have enough time to take them off. So I just had to hope for the best, and luckily, nothing bad happened that day.
I had arranged to live with a cousin in LA. Once I was there, I was enrolled in school, but I did not know the language at first. It was scary and confusing, but I slowly started to learn English. And I also got a part-time job selling produce on the weekends, so I was finally able to send money back to my grandmother. I was doing what I set out to do and more.
Everything looked so different in the US. The streets were clean, and we felt happy again. My brother actually helped me get my first job at a restaurant as a dishwasher and person who organized everything. When I got my first check of $200, I immediately sent all of it to my mom, and it made her really happy and proud of me. That's when I knew that everything was going to be okay.
In the US, my brother and I met some people who were carpenters and taught us the trade for 7 months, took us in as family. Even though I was living in a two-bedroom apartment with four other men, I just kept thinking how fortunate I was. Started to make good money, and I was finally able to send some of it back to my parents. I hoped that my father would then forgive me for leaving.
very surprised to find that there are so many kind and helpful people here, and that there's so much to do. There was never jobs in Mexico that we needed so badly, but in the United States, I found myself a job sewing clothes from 5 a.m. to noon. Since I did not speak English, a friend of mine helped me get a job, which was a great help to me.
This is Lupita, my friend I was telling you about. She's here for the job.
Hi, Lupita. It's nice to meet you. Can you sew?
¿Puedes coser?
Sí. Yes.
Fine. Have her train with you. Welcome, Lupita.
Thank you.
I went to night school in order to learn English. It was hard for me to fit in without knowing English. I was struggling at work and in public places. Can you imagine how embarrassing that is? Little by little, my English improved. Eventually, I went to night school. I was able to obtain my high school diploma.
No, if she doesn't pass physics, she won't graduate.
Come on, I have an idea. Let's go talk to her teachers.
My friends took it upon themselves to talk to my physics teacher, and they convinced him to help me after school. I would go every day or so to receive help. And a couple weeks passed, and it was test time. And I passed, and I was able to graduate. All thanks to my friends and my physics teacher.
I was finally able to get a green card so I could go back to Mexico to visit my family. It was great to talk to my father and embrace him again and tell him about what life was like in America. You know, he finally agreed that it was worth the risk for me to leave for all north there. When I got back to the U.S., I was able to get a job for the city of Mountain View, where I worked for many years.
I was finally able to send for my daughters and we were a family again. My biggest goal coming to the U.S. was to make my daughters realize that hard work pays off. I don't want my daughters to work outside in the fields like when they were very young. I want them to improve themselves and be important people in life. That is the thing that would make me most proud of. The day we reunited was the best day of my life.
I waited for this day so long. Let me look at you.
I missed you.
Bello, mama. You have grown so much. Thank goodness you made it all right. I have so many things to show you. I know you will love your new home.
I worked many odd jobs, but eventually, I was hired by the city library. There, I could teach. I was finally able to read to children during the story hour. When I left Mexico, I was sure that I would never see a child's face light up while teaching them something new. I never expected to be the first person in my family to graduate high school and have a stable job. I learned that you can do anything, you just have to put everything you have into it. I push my kids to do their best so they can go to high school, so they can go to college and achieve something I will never do.
Today, I'm happy to have gone through it all. I know that if I had stayed in Mexico, it would have been hard to make a living. And I'd probably be in a lot of debt because it's hard to provide for a family there. Here in the United States, I've created an amazing and supportive family. I hope to keep working and save up enough money to buy a house, one that me and my wife can spend the rest of our lives in. After living in the United States for 21 years, I've accomplished a huge goal of mine. I was able to get my green card and visit my mom back in Mexico.
Life today is great. I had a long-term job as a janitor, and I worked myself up to manager. I decided to start my own cleaning company.
which is something that I've always wanted to do, because I can finally be my own boss. I feel very proud about that. But there are things I do miss from Mexico, my family and my liberty. In Mexico, I did not have to be worried about ICE because I was legal. But in the United States, I do. I just wish I had my liberty like I did back then. But after some time in the US, I became a mother. When I had my kids, I knew right then and there that me leaving Mexico was the best thing that could have happened to me. I was able to provide a future for my kids where they can go to school and college and find the jobs for their families. I was now able to show my children that this is what life is all about. Being able to make a future for yourself. I felt for the first time in a long time that I wasn't alone anymore. But that was many years ago. At this point, I'm an abuela. And my kids are passing that mentality onto their children, who are much better off than I was at their age. I hope my grandchildren are all able to go to college, find a successful career path of their choice, and pass on the virtues of life to their children, like how I did with mine. My departure from Mexico left a permanent mark on my life. Nothing is without sacrifice. You see, my grandmother passed away of a heart attack, and I could not be there for her funeral. But by encouraging me to come to El Norte, she gave me the greatest gift of all, the chance to create a future for myself and my family.
Life has continued to bless me. I have my two beautiful daughters who motivate me and keep me going every day. I work in an office now, and I feel proud of myself every single day. Not for learning the language, not for obtaining a job. I am most proud of having the courage to be an immigrant in the United States of America.
También hablamos en español, así que siéntanse libres de también hacernos preguntas en español.
Yes. So the question is, why did we pick the concept for the play? Does anybody want to answer that? Okay, Michaela.
Well, starting like towards the end of last semester, we were talking about doing something like a play on something that impacted not only like us, but like the community around us and then the world in general. And so Nanor and Elliot have been working with this Make America?
Made to America,
where they get stories from different students about someone in their family that immigrated. And then Amy and Elliot connected, and this is how this came.
Did I answer your question? Yeah, okay. Thank you. Don't all speak at once. Here. Yes.
Can you pick specific stories that you guys portrayed?
The question was, how did we pick the specific stories? So does anyone want to cover that, or?
I can do it.
All right, go for it.
So for one, it's not one specific story. It's actually a mixture of different stories. So they took up stories from different classes and different peoples and kind of intertwined them. Because a lot of these stories, a lot of these people have gone through similar things. And the stories kind of overlap in certain areas. So we brought in certain things from different stories. Even a lot of students, they remember stories specific from their parents' narrative. So like you can find pieces of different narratives throughout. So there isn't just four or five narratives.
Six.
I'm sorry. There's a bunch of variation of different ones.
Yes.
How did this play impact you?
Gabby.
I think a lot of us, like, we know, like, we've heard our stories, right? Like, some of us have even, like, been in the position that these people have. But it's, like, different for me, at least. Like, I've grown up hearing the stories, but you never actually realize how much it really impacted a person until you, like, when I did this play, I realized how much it actually impacted my parents and how much it actually meant when they came over here. So that's how it impacted me.
Can I add on?
Absolutely.
Sure. I think, personally for me, like, I think, like I said last night, I got a lot more respect of this culture and of everybody who's been through this, you know, because it is a struggle and it's a battle continuously, and it's, you know, it hasn't stopped and it's not going to stop. And even though there are things in the world that are trying to stop it and people in the world who are trying to stop it, that was really cool to me because, you know, I didn't know nothing about these stories, you know. So this is my culture. I didn't grow up hearing anything about it because, you know, most of the things I heard about was Martin Luther King and Malcolm X, you know. So learning about this and, you know, the different sides, like, you know, they were on the other side in the South and then were over here, you know, in New Mexico and California and all that and coming to the border. It was really cool. And that respect went up for me because I had always thought that, you know, our stories were so different and that they couldn't really intertwine and connect the way they do. But doing this play, I thought it was really cool and to see the similarities. So that was really cool.
The biggest thing for me was an appreciation. I've heard this story, my mom's told it, my aunts have told it. But biggest thing for me was my mom crossed the border when she was 18. I'm 18 right now. And like understanding is, I've never truly understood and felt the responsibilities of crossing the border. And being in this play, I got a piece of it, but I could never like truly appreciate and understand what my mom had to go through in order to be here. And because of the sacrifice she did, the sacrifice her family did, leaving the place she was comfortable, I remember asking my mom, when she left, did she want to? She really said no. It was scary, it was hard. But because of the sacrifices that she did when she was younger, I'm here today and I'm looking at college. And if it wasn't for my mom and all these moms and parents who've done the sacrifice, we wouldn't be here today.
Anyone else want to add to that?
Kyla
wasn't
about that either.
Okay.
Kyla. How did you guys get into your roles?
So the question was, how did they get into their roles? Anyone
want to
take that?
So a lot of us are Hispanic. They're mostly, like, kind of half of the country Hispanic.
so we could already relate to most of the stories, because a lot of the narratives are from our parents too. So we heard the story from them, but probably the hardest part was telling their story through our play, because I feel like every actor can relate when I say this, but as an actor, your main goal is to move the crowd and like leave the crowd with an impact and leave them thinking after the show. So the way I got into the role is, I just thought like, how would I feel if I had to cross the border, like the amount of fear that they go through. And also, a lot of the Spanish really helps to make it more authentic.
Does anyone else have a comment on that question?
I can go.
Yeah, go.
For me, it was, I'm leaving to college in a couple of weeks. And it's nothing compared to like leaving the family in the country, but it's leaving comfort and leaving the place where you feel safe and secure, even if it's in a country where a lot of stuff is happening. Like, we hear a lot of stories, there's a lot of gang violence, there's government stuff, but it was still a place of where you're from, where you knew you were comfortable. And that's why I feel here at Eastside. So like, for me getting to character, I just thought of leaving here, leaving people that I'm comfortable with, people that I'm safe. So like, just the thought of that for me was like, how would I feel if I had to leave everything?
For me, I hate to follow, but for me, for someone who isn't a Spanish speaker, I got into my role, I talked to a lot of the cast who could relate and try to get a better understanding of my role. I also did a lot of reading over. We were all assigned partners to help us with our Spanish, so the pronunciation was correct. And just with acting, it's always just putting yourself in those people's shoes, and I feel like it's something that we can all relate to in a way if we just look at it a different way. Like, for me, I probably wouldn't have thought about this if it wasn't for drama and putting myself in those shoes. So just being able to have that opportunity and to act it out, which is something that I feel most comfortable with.
Other questions?
Yes.
Do you want to be acting?
So the question was, you mean like professional actor? Is that what you mean? Anybody up here have aspirations to act professionally?
Michaela, Emil.
All of you should have your aspirations.
What does it mean?
I would say, Amy, can I
am I missing something? Yeah, go ahead.
So, for me personally, no. But this was still something I wanted to do now that I have the chance to actually do it. So, while I was still here at Eastside, this is probably the most welcoming like drama class I could ever think of. It's like, people, we all like work together, we're all in this play together. We all do a lot of this ourselves. You know, we don't work with too many different departments. It's all just from us. What can we do, what can we create with just our minds? And can we do that, you know, can we portray that on the stage? And so just to get the experience to do this, if you have any desire to join, if you even think about doing it, do it, okay? While you still have the chance, while later in life, you never know how much time you're gonna have, how busy you'll be, what other commitments you have. I'm doing this now while I have the chance, and I was really grateful that I could. I just wanted to say that.
I wanted to take something up what Kelly said. She said that normally that we only work in our own department, but this show's been really unusual because we brought in a lot of departments from the school. Is Angela and Stephanie still here? Yes. Okay. So we brought in Angela and Stephanie to help us choreograph because I am not familiar nor good at folklorico. So I brought them in. So they're from the dance department. Of course, we're here. I approached Jansen And if you notice in your program, we have originally composed music just for this show. Okay, one of them was right there.
Is Roxanna Bravo in the house?
No, Roxanna?
Okay, so Roxanna.
Juan Mendoza, last night?
Yeah, she was. Yeah.
And Priscilla. So they all got together, Jansen under his guidance. Jansen and Ellie and I met, and we're like, hey, do you think it's possible? And Jansen's always so awesome in a group. I was like, yeah, we'll see what we can do about it. And it was great because Giselle was in the show, and she was in class, so she was kind of able to orchestrate where and what kind of tone that we wanted. And then, of course, we had, from the language department, I asked Holly to help me out with some translating. So that made it really. And then, of course, with Lenore, the history department or the humanities department, where it all actually began. So it's amazing to have not one department, not two, not three, not four, but, you know, pretty much a good chunk of, I felt, of the school helping us with that. I know. Go ahead, Lenore.
Maybe there's one last appreciation I want to point out. There's, because I know these stories because I've read them over the years, but
come up this way because we can't hear you because only the microphones are up here. So that way.
In the audience, there's actually personal people whose stories are actually here, which I don't want to point out, but they're here and I can see them. And either some of you guys might recognize your own stories that you literally wrote this in your own words. These are your words. And we don't want to point your stories out or you out for confidentiality reasons, but there's also moms and dads whose stories are in here and they're here today. So without acknowledging who they are specifically, can we just give them a hand? Yeah.
Josh? No? Nobody else?